In this video, we'll study about the fourth ventricle of the brain. This is the fourth ventricle. The fourth ventricle is a tent-like cavity of the hindbrain lined with ependymema and filled with cerebrospinal fluid. It is situated in the posterior cranial fossa in front of the cerebellum, behind the pons and upper part of the medulla oblongata. The cavity of the ventricle presents a triangular outline in a sagittal section and appears a rhomboidal in shape in the horizontal section. It is continuous inferiorly with the central canal of the lower part of the medulla oblongata, and superiorly it is continuous with the cerebral aqueduct of the midbrain. Next, we'll see the recesses of the fourth ventricle. They are 5 in number, and these are the extension from the cavity of the fourth ventricle. You have 2 lateral recesses, one on each side, extend laterally in the interval between the inferior cerebellar peduncle ventrally and the peduncle of the flocculus dorsally. The lateral extremity of the recess reaches up to the flocculus and opens into the subarachnoid space of the cerebellopontine angle as the lateral aperture or the foramen of Lushka, through which the part of choroid plexus bulges out. In this picture you can see this is the lateral aperture, the foramen of Lushka, through which the choroid plexus bulges out and the fourth ventricle communicates with the subarachnoid space of the cerebellopontine angle. Next, we'll see the median dorsal recess. It extends into the white core of the cerebellum just above the nodule, cranial to the nodule. In this picture you can see this is the median dorsal recess, which extends into the white core of the cerebellum just above the nodule. So this is the nodule, just above the nodule you have the median dorsal recess. Then you have 2 lateral dorsal recess or dorsal lateral recess, one on each side of the median dorsal recess. It projects dorsally above the inferior medullary velum immediately lateral to the nodule. Next, we'll see the angles of the fourth ventricle. The cavity of the fourth ventricle has 4 angles: a superior angle, then you have the inferior angle, and then you have 2 lateral angles. The superior angle is continuous above with the cerebral aqueduct of the midbrain. The inferior angle is continuous below with the central canal of the lower part of the medulla oblongata or the closed part of the medulla oblongata, and 2 lateral angles on either side, which are carried outwards across the dorsal surface of the inferior cerebellar peduncle as tubular pouches, which are called as the lateral recess. Next, we'll see the boundaries of the fourth ventricle. First, we'll see the lateral boundaries or the lateral walls. On each side, the fourth ventricle is bounded infralaterally by the inferior cerebellar peduncle, sublimated by the gracile and the cuneate tubercles, and supralaterally by the superior cerebellar peduncles. Next, we'll see the roof or the posterior wall. The roof of the fourth ventricle is tent shape and it has the upper and the lower sloping surfaces. The apex of the tent extend posteriorly into the white core of the cerebellum. The upper part of the roof is formed by the convergence of the 2 superior cerebellar peduncle and a thin sheet of white matter, that is the superior medullary velum, which bridges the triangular gap between the two superior cerebellar peduncles. On it lies the lingula of the superior vermis of the cerebellum. So in this picture you can see this is a sagittal section. So this is the roof of the fourth ventricle and this is the apex which projects into the white core of the cerebellum. So this is the upper part of the roof which is formed by the two superior cerebellar peduncles. In the middle it is bridged by the superior medullary velum and on it lies the lingula of the superior vermis of the cerebellum. This is the lower part of the roof which is formed by the thin sheet of non-nervous tissue, the inferior medullary velum, which is formed conjointly by the ventricular ependyma and the pia mater that covers it posteriorly. It is intimately related to the nodule of the inferior vermis of the cerebellum. The lower part of the inferior medullary velum has a large aperture that is known as the median aperture or the foramen of Magenti, through which the cavity of the fourth ventricle communicates with the subarachnoid space of the cerebellomedullary cistern or cisterna magna. Next we'll see about the tela choroidea of the fourth ventricle. The tela choroidea of the fourth ventricle is a double layer fold of pia mater between the inferior vermis of the cerebellum and the lower part of the roof of the fourth ventricle. Its dorsal layer lines the inferior vermis and it reaches the nodule and gets reflected upon itself to form its ventral layer. When traced laterally, the dorsal layer is continuous with the pia mater covering the cerebellar hemisphere. The ventral layer lies on the roof of the lower part of the fourth ventricle and it is continuous with the pia mater covering the dorsal surface of the medulla oblongata. Next we'll see about the choroid plexus of the fourth ventricle. The capillary plexus of the blood vessels between the two layers of the tela choroidea form the rich vascular fringe that project through the lower part of the roof of the fourth ventricle to form the choroid plexus. It is derived from the branches of posterior inferior cerebellar arteries. The plexus project into the cavity through the lower part of the roof and the entire plexus is T-shaped where the vertical limb of the T is double with the foramen of Magenti intervenes between the two limbs. The horizontal limb of the plexus on either side, they extend into the lateral recess and protrudes to the lateral aperture or the foramen of Lushka into the subarachnoid space and can be seen on the surface of the brain near the flocculus. This is a diagrammatic representation of the floor of the fourth ventricle. The floor of the fourth ventricle is also known as the rhomboid fossa. The floor of the fourth ventricle is formed by the posterior surface of the pons and the upper part of the medulla oblongata. It is a rhomboid in shape. Because of its shape, the floor of the fourth ventricle is also known as the rhomboid fossa. It is divided into three parts. The upper triangular part, which is formed by the posterior surface of the pons. The lower triangular part is formed by the upper part of the posterior surface of the medulla oblongata and the intermediate part at the junction of the medulla on the pons and it is prolonged laterally on either side over the inferior cerebellar peduncle as the floor of the lateral recess. This part is bounded above by a base of the upper triangular part of the floor below by a line joining the horizontal parts of the tinea. The surface of the intermediate part is marked by the presence of delicate bundles of transversely arranged fibers, the stria medullaris. So this is the stria medullaris. So this is a diagrammatic representation. Here you can see this is the upper part of the floor of the fourth ventricle, which is formed by the posterior surface of the pons, and this is a lower part of the floor of the fourth ventricle, which is formed by the posterior surface of the upper part of the medulla oblongata, and this is the intermediate part, which is formed by the stria medullaris. Next we'll see the features of the floor of the fourth ventricle. The floor of the fourth ventricle exhibits the following feature. The entire floor is divided into the right and the left symmetrical half by a median sulcus. So this is the sulcus. On either side of the median sulcus, there is a longitudinal elevation that is called as the medial eminence. The medial eminence is bounded laterally by the sulcus limitans. So sulcus limitans, which limits the sulcus, it's a depression, linear depression, which limits the medial eminence is the sulcus limitans. So median sulcus, medial eminence, then sulcus limitans. The region lateral to the sulcus limitans overlies the vestibular nuclei, hence it is called as the vestibular area. So this area is called as the vestibular area. This area lies partly in the pons and partly in the medulla oblongata. So the area lateral to the sulcus limitans is known as the vestibular area, which overlies the vestibular nuclei. This area lies partly in the pons and partly in the medulla oblongata. The upper end of the sulcus limitans widens into a triangular depression that is called as the superior fovea. Above the superior fovea, the sulcus limitans flattens out and presents a bluish gray area that is called as the locus ceruleus. The color is imparted by the underlying group of nerve cells containing the melanin pigment, which constitute the substantia ferruginea. The neurons of the locus ceruleus contains large quantities of noradrenaline or norepinephrine. The lower part of the sulcus limitans presents a small depression, that is the inferior fovea. On either side of the medial eminence shows an oval swelling in the pontine part of the floor at the level of the superior fovea, that is known as the facial colliculus. The swelling is produced by the fibers of the motor nucleus of the facial nerve hooking around the abducens nucleus, that is the internal genu of the facial nerve. From the inferior fovea, the sulcus limitans descends obliquely towards the median sulcus. So this divides the median eminence in the medullary part of the floor into two triangles. A hypoglossal triangle above and the vagal triangle below. The hypoglossal triangle is divided by a faint line furrow into a medial part, which overlies the nucleus of the hypoglossal nerve, and a lateral part, which overlies the nucleus intercalatus. The vagal triangle overlies the nucleus of the vagus, glossopharyngeal, and the cranial accessory nerve. The vagal triangle is crossed by a narrow translucent ridge, that is the funiculus separens, a small area between the funiculus separens above and the gracile tubercle below. It is known as the area postrema. This area consists of highly vascular neuroglial tissue. The lower part of the floor of the fourth ventricle, it resembles the pen nib. Hence, it is known as the calamus cryptorhis. The area postrema is an important chemoreceptor area that triggers the vomiting in response to the presence of emetic substance in the blood. The infralateral margins of the fourth ventricle are marked by a narrow white ridge, that is the tinea. The two tinea meets at the inferior angle of the ventricle to form a small fold, that is called as the obex. The obex forms the roof of the inferior angle of the fourth ventricle. The term obex is often used to denote the inferior angle of the fourth ventricle. So beneath the floor of the superior half of the fourth ventricle, you have the abducens nerve nucleus surrounded by the internal genu of the facial nerve, and then you have the vestibular nuclei. Beneath the inferior half of the floor, you have the vestibular nuclei, then you have the dorsal nucleus of the vagus, the nucleus intercalatus, the hypoglossal nucleus, the true vomiting centers, and the vital centers. There are five apertures or openings in the fourth ventricle through which the cerebrospinal fluid can leave the cavity of the fourth ventricle. You have the central aperture in the roof, that is the foramen of Magenti. Then you have two lateral apertures on either side in the roof, that is the foramen of Lushka. Then you have the central canal of the medulla oblongata and the cerebral aqueduct of the midbrain. Out of these five openings, the CSF can pass from the cavity of the fourth ventricle into the subarachnoid space only through the three openings in the roof, that is the foramen of Magenti and the foramen of Lushka on either side. When you see the clinical correlation, the most common tumor in this region is the medulloblastoma. It arises from poorly differentiated primitive neuroectodermal cells of the cerebellar vermis, and it occurs mostly in children. The medulloblastoma is highly malignant and produces the signs and the symptoms of cerebellar lesion, or it may press upon the vital centers located beneath the floor of the fourth ventricle, causing cardiac irregularities, tachycardia, irregular respiration, and vasomotor disturbances. Next, we'll see the internal hydrocephalus. If the openings in the roof of the fourth ventricle are blocked by a growing tumor, or as a result of formation of fibrous adhesions in the subarachnoid space during meningitis, the CSF cannot escape from the ventricular system into the subarachnoid space. This will lead to excessive accumulation of CSF within the ventricular system, producing the internal hydrocephalus.